If any of you know my mother, you know this will not be the shortest funeral you've ever been to. So you might want to find a seat. And we've got guards at every door to make sure you don't leave until it's over. So I'm doing okay to start with. I just don't know how well I'll do throughout the whole process. So just warning you ahead of time. So thank you, everybody, for coming. And there's still empty seats here. And I don't know, it might be awkward in a funeral if I, the officiator, comes back there and hands, you know, leads you by the hand to come sit here. So please come forward. Mike, Jessica, come on. John, Brad, let's go. Come on. You guys are going to make me do it. Lonnie, Travis, Michelle, come on. Neil, you shouldn't be afraid of being in front of people, Neil. Come on. Bob, carry on. We have a seat right here, and it has your name on it. Okay, we've got like 10 more seats up here. Okay, so for those of you that are wondering why it's taken so long to get started, it's the people who are standing around the sanctuary. Just wanted to tell you that right up front. I don't know why this is always the case. When I'm sitting down, whether it's in church or in a Bible study, the seats beside me are always the ones that are empty. I don't really know what I'm supposed to take from that. Good thing I'm standing right now because nobody has to stand beside me. I just want to read what my mom said that she'd like happen here. Yeah. May this be a celebration of all the Lord has done in my life and how blessed I've been with the family he's given me. That was a statement she put in. Because if you know my mom, you know she has details. And so she had things she wanted. And so a lot of the things we'll be doing today are what she asked for. And some extras along the way maybe. But she would be happy to have a big crowd. If you know my mother. I'm dry. Does that mean I'm nervous? I don't know. But she would like a big crowd. She liked parties. She liked being where people were at. She loved people. So thank you for coming. She would be very appreciative that you're here. We're here to celebrate the life of Janet Iris Lawson. And I want to thank you for being a part of it. Let's start with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day. To celebrate the life of somebody who loved you so much and loved people so much. And I think it's shown by even who's here today. I pray that everything we do and say will bring you honor and glory and will be true to who she was and who she wanted to be known as. Thank you, Lord, for this time together. And just guide us along the way and give me whatever strength I need to get through it. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to start with a song. There's a couple things we're doing at the beginning that kind of bring to a focus what mom would want us focusing on today. So we're going to listen to a song, and I know it's hard, but listen to the song, and I think we're going to have the lyrics to it. So you know it. Please play.
Make it count, leave a mark, build a name for yourself. Dream your dreams, chase your heart above all else. Make a name the world remembers. But all an empty world can sell is empty dreams. I got lost in the lie that it was up to me to make a name the world remembers. But Jesus is the only name to remember. And Jesus, remember me, only Jesus.
I'm going to read scripture today in Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 through 14, verse 17, and then verse 20 and 21. Says, not that I've already attained or I'm already perfected, but I press on. That I may lay hold of that which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward calling of God in Christ Jesus. Verse 17 says, brethren, join in following my example and note those who so walk as you have us for a pattern. Goes on to say in verse 20, for our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his glorious body according to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself.
Good afternoon. Wow, there are so many people here. If you know Janet, you know that she loved to worship and praise the Lord. So would you stand and do that with us today?
So everything we picked so far was to kind of set the stage for what we know mom would want the attitude and the atmosphere to be for her funeral. Even the idea of Philippians 3 talked about that, not that you, Paul was saying, not that I've already attained, but I press toward the mark. And that was mom. She was always pressing toward Christ's likeness. It was never that she already got there. She knew she was still a sinner, but she was always pressing forward. And she was looking forward to the day when she would be in heaven and see Jesus. And if you know her closely, you know that that was a truth in her life. And then that passage, it says, for our citizenship is in heaven, for which we also eagerly await. And that was my mother. So we picked that. And that hymn where we just sang was one of her favorite hymns. And it says, to God be the glory. We're going to have a time of openness. We have a mic somewhere. I think I have it right here. And if you'd like to share, and we use all the other stuff because that's the way mom would want this focus of the sharing to be, for God to get the glory. But if you would like to share, we would like you to have that opportunity. And we're going to have somebody running. And I didn't pick somebody ahead of time. So do I have a volunteer? Ralph, can you move fast enough? Yeah. You are kind of a big guy. You might not be able to fit through the rows. So if you'd like to share, just put your hand up and he'll give you a thing.
Well, I had the privilege of meeting Miss Janet. I was her dialysis technician for over 2 years. And what a glory that was. She helped me to grow so strong and trust in the Lord. Show me when I was wrong and what the Lord would expect me to do. Scripture after scripture, we memorized. And I even beat her sometimes in memorizing the scripture. She used to say, wow, I guess you beat me on that one. But, you know, we had a lot of fun. And I want to give her, she doesn't like the credit, but she helped me to stay married to my husband. You know, we shared a lot of things. One time I was saying how, you know, the Lord led me to Dennis. And it was like a few months later, it was really bad. And I said, I'm done. I can't do it anymore. And I could see Janet praying. She always had her eyes closed. And she was praying. And I was doing the setup and everything. And I sat down. She goes, Ginger, I have one question for you. And I said, yeah. I'm thinking, okay, here it comes. And she said, do you remember when you told me you thought the Lord brought Dennis in your life? And I said, yeah. She goes, well, who are you to say God's wrong? And I just hung my head, and I'm like, I'm not. So I stayed with Dennis, and I'm so glad I did. He's come to the Lord. He's been baptized. He's growing. And, you know, I'm really going to miss the encouragement I got from her. But I know she's in my heart and watching over me.
Ralph.
So when I was a little girl, what I remember about Janet, I'm just going to say a few different things. We went to church together, my mom and her, and she were really good friends. And all I remember about her was that I wanted to be like her. And this was when I was a little girl. She always smelled so sweet. And she was a soft, sweet woman who always had a big smile on her face. And she always made things seem fun. I didn't know then, though, and I loved watching her sing. She had a beautiful voice, and not only did she just sing, but she sang with passion and because she meant it. So I loved watching her sing. I didn't know then, though, that she was going to be my mother-in-law. So she was always doing things for other people and always thinking of other people. When I was, when we were going to get married, she took me shopping for wedding things, and she was always doing things for me. Even when she physically couldn't, she'd say, what can I do to lighten your load? What can I do for you? And I'd be like, I'm the one that's healthy. I can do this. But even down to bringing me some of my favorite flowers for my birthday, which was only a few weeks ago, and she could barely even make it up the steps to the porch and come in, but she was gonna do it. Always giving me advice. I will always miss the advice. Even if it was things that I was maybe annoyed with her son. She would always... But she was the one that I would talk to, and she was always understanding. She knew where I was coming from, and then she would give me godly advice. We wouldn't end with bad conversation.
What do you mean by that?
She... No. She would pray with me, and she'd give me scripture, and she always gave me good advice. I will definitely always miss that. I know some people might complain about their in-laws, but I have never had anything that I could have ever said bad about my in-laws. My mother-in-law was the best mother-in-law I've ever had. And I had my...
How many of you had?
And ever will have. This wasn't supposed to be funny. Okay. I had my mom, my aunt has a plant. I guess it's called the snake plant. And the common name for it is the mother-in-law's tongue. I don't think it's meant to be a positive thing. I think that's supposed to be a bad thing. But my mother-in-law's tongue brought healing. It brought encouragement. It brought hope to people. She was always building me up. Even when I knew my own evil heart, she would say things about me that were so wonderful that made me want to be better. So my mother-in-law's tongue was a beautiful tongue.
This is to the Robert Lawson family. Janet was one of the most godly women and influential for Christ's kingdom I've ever known. I've been connected one way or another with Janet, Bob, Suzanne, and George in so many ways and for so many years. Janet goes back to 1973 in the Billy Graham movie Time to Run at the local cinema. When she gave her testimony at the end of one of the showings, and my daughter Courtney, age 5, went forward to accept Christ. Courtney and I just talked about that the other night when I told my daughters about Janet's death. It has been a joy, an honor, and a privilege, professionally and personally, to have these more than casual connections with the Lawsons. Janet's life in Christ and its deeply felt impact in all the ways I have observed has provided spiritual nourishment to my soul. Here is my view of Janet's Christian influence in the life of her family, this church, the River of Life Camp, and the larger Christian community in the Northeast Kingdom. First, her testimony at Time to Run brought my daughter to Jesus Christ. You know how important Word of Life was and is in the Lawson family? It goes back to an evangelist named Jack Wurtzen. I accepted Christ at the age of 6 at a Jack Wurtzen crusade in Poughkeepsie, New York. That's a bond that I share with many in this room. I had the honor of kneeling next to Jack in 93 at his granddaughter's graduation and mine from Wheaton College and telling him I was a star in his crown. Jack Wurtzen is watching here today. Second, and probably most important, Janet's love, grace, long-suffering in so many ways, and her prayers are singularly responsible for Bob coming to Christ, George's ministry, Suzanne's work in keeping things running on track for the family businesses, the camp, the church. You can go on and on. And others will add to this to see her influence. Without a doubt in my mind, Janet was the human rock upon which this family stands. Third, her journey of failed kidneys, without a complaint that I ever heard, her joy and smile and prayer life were daily testimonies to God's grace at work. She knew better than most of us what it meant to share in the fellowship of his sufferings. The day she died her physical death, she heard, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." And the choirs of heaven sang to her the words of Proverbs 31, 10 through 31. And what a worthy woman she was. To Bob, on a personal note, I can only say what they said about me at Gail's funeral. Bob, you married way up.
George is smiling. I knew Janet when she was 15. I knew Robert when he was a little bit younger. I knew George when he was 15. These are beautiful, beautiful people, and thanks for allowing me to say a word.
Janet was my sister-in-law, but really she was my sister. She's the one that led me to Christ, even though I didn't know it. She planted the seed one day when I was out picking rocks in a cornfield. She said, "Now's a good time to save you." And I said, "No, I'm busy right now." I guess that's about all I'm gonna hold together for, but she was a wonderful woman.
I've got a funny story to tell about Janet. I'm related to her by marriage. To try to explain it would be too complicated. But when she married Bob the second time, she wanted to wear her wedding gown that she'd worn the first time. But she didn't want it to be the same color. So we filled a bathtub in my house with tea. And we put the dress in it, and we stirred it around. We didn't know if it would work. I mean, I really wasn't sure what the fabric was, whether it would take what we were doing to it. But it took, and she wore it. And it was a hilarious day. We were just kind of stirring that around with a big stick in the bathtub. But anyway, that was a one day we shared. But we did share the Lord in common, and she's a precious friend and sister, and I look forward to seeing her again when my time comes.
My name's Tom Phillips, and Faye is with me from Word of Life over in Scroon Lake, and we bring greetings from Don Locke, who's out of the country but wished he could be here. We were in Florida for about 20 years directing the ministry. It was a youth ministry, and we decided to start an RV park right in the middle of the property. And so we had dozens and dozens of retirees coming from all walks of life, from all different backgrounds. And frankly, I had no clue what to do with all these people. And Bob Lawson and Janet came, and they helped to bring unity. They got people on the same page. They got people praying. Everybody knew Janet was sick. She never, ever complained. They were an incredible influence on that whole ministry, on that whole property. And we were very, very thankful for Janet and for Bob.
Would anyone else like to share?
I only knew Janet a short time, but in the time that I knew her, she definitely impacted me. She was always thinking of others. I remember one Sunday coming in, and she came up, and she had made my kids some chocolate chip cookie bars, and it was really special that, you know, she barely knew me, but she's still thinking of me, and she was always thinking of others and always made time to talk and share the gospel with people. And she really impacted me in the short time I knew her.
Yes, I met Janet years ago before we attended here at this church, and she just was such a spirit, a huge spirit. It just leaves an indelible mark on me. and on anybody that who came across her path. And she was familiar with the house I was staying in, and every time I'd see her, she goes, "You know, I'm praying for you and your family." And I don't know, she's just so special. And I miss her. Thank you.
Janet was a strong mainstay for all of us ladies here between New Hope Bible in Brannington and New Hope here in Irisburg. She was a leader. If you didn't know the Lord, she'd bring you to the Lord. And if you did know the Lord, she'd walk beside you, just like our Lord would walk beside us. The women's conferences that she helped head up and lead just gave each and every one of us new hope. Gave us strength to make it through failed marriages, illnesses, whatever we were going through, she'd walk beside you. And she's going to be so missed by all of us ladies because she was such a strong woman, even in her weakness. The Lord shined her right through.
So when I moved to Vermont, after graduating from Word of Life to work here in the kitchen, I knew nobody. And my very first day, it was my birthday when I moved up here, and didn't know a single soul. I walk into the kitchen and there's a birthday card sitting on the counter. And I said, "A birthday card? I've never even met this woman before." And from that day on, Janet and I hit it right off. We were very closely with the snack shack and everything. And when I heard of Janet's passing, I was on my way to a meeting about an hour from my home, and I was in the car with one of my coworkers, and I just started talking, and I didn't realize, I didn't stop talking until the ignition was shut off and we got to the meeting. I looked at my coworker and I said, "Oh my goodness, I'm so sorry I didn't shut up." And she said, "Man, I wish I could have met this woman." And that just really resonated with me because everyone Janet met, they loved, and I just can't wait to see her in glory.
This is hard, but I loved her from the minute I met her, and I too benefited from her advice and her prayers. And especially one night, it was 3 o'clock in the morning, and I was struggling with some marital problems, and she knew. She had a sixth sense, and she knew. She called me and prayed with me in the middle of the night. And I will be eternally grateful for our friendship. Look forward to seeing her.
It's okay if I come up with you. So, many of you guys know I pastor with George here at New Hope Bible Church. One of the things I just want to say about Janet is, and for all of us really, is never underestimate the power of prayer. My first interaction with Janet was one of the youth group leaders when I was a kid growing up, and I got to spend some time with her till age 18. And then age 18, Patrick and I got in some trouble in youth group, but the grace that she gave us, even in spite of that, was amazing. But for three to four years, I walked away from the Lord. And I think of Janet like she's like the New Testament James. You know, she was a prayer warrior. You knew if she said she was going to pray for you, she was going to pray for you. In fact, I think Bob had said at one point, it took her so long to pray, you know. But when I came back to the Lord and George did premarriage counseling with us, and my wife got saved through that, and then he married us. Janet came up to me after, once I started getting into the church, and she said, "I just want you to know that you were always on my daily prayer list." And she was one that you knew that was true to, you know. It wasn't just like, "Hey, you know, you're on my daily prayer list," and you knew she didn't pray for you. So one thing I'm going to really miss is the fact that, you know, one of the prayer warriors is gone, you know. She's in heaven, but hopefully some of us will step up and pray maybe like she did, especially for those. One thing she also saw, too, she was soft-spoken, but she also saw, I think, the best in people. And she even said, "I knew there was something about you. you know, and I don't know what that is yet, but hopefully someday I'll find it. And I think one of the reasons I'm a pastor now and good friends with George is because she prayed hard for me and prayed hard for us. So a lot of the stuff you see here, I think, is due to the fact that she was a prayer warrior, but also because God brought her and Bob together. So absolutely amazing. So.
Would anyone else like to share?
It's been fun to get to know Janet and Bob and the Lawson family and Martins and Ralph Tuschetsky. And my wife and I and kids have been coming up for years helping with the night corn maze. That's the first concept we heard of the church up here, and Jen and I had many conversations back and forth pre the weekend or 2 weekends getting ready for corn maze, but always making sure things were ready. And I just appreciated her sending notes and just praying, and miss her just enthusiasm, times that she couldn't do but she was still here, and I was amazed. But honor and privilege to know a lady who loved the Lord and now with the Lord. So look forward to seeing her again in heaven. I have that hope, and hopefully if you don't know that today, you'll understand a little bit more about that. Anyone else to share?
They're afraid if they share too long, they'll be here forever. And they can smell the food in the back and they're afraid they'll miss the supper. So next couple things we're going to do, the next thing that's happening is actually a song that my mother wrote years ago. And if any of you knew my mother, like, years, have you known her for a long time, she loved to sing. That was really difficult for my mom. The first step was she learned to play guitar from Marion's here today. She learned to play guitar. She loved to sing. First thing was her hands, and she had to stop playing guitar. And the hardest thing, I think, was when she lost her voice and couldn't sing anymore. But this is a song that she wrote and would play with her guitar and sing. And then after that, we're going to have, she wrote on her thing, like I said, she put stuff down, and she said, some of my favorite verses that God has used to get me through the tough times. And six of the grandchildren are just going to come up and just read the verses that she wanted read to you guys so that you would have them. But this is a song that my mom wrote.
The title of the song is Suffering to Joy, and Janet wrote this in 1982. And she has a couple of verses associated with this, Psalm 126, 5 and 6, which say, those who sow in tears shall reap with joyful shouting. He who goes to and fro weeping, carrying his bag of seed, shall indeed come again with a shout of joy, bringing his sheaves with him. And we know, I can't say enough about Janet. Love her dearly, I'm going to miss her deeply. But you know, one thing about Janet, she shared her faith with anyone she could, and she will be bringing sheaves with her. And she was out to bring as many people to Jesus as she possibly could. This is called Suffering to Joy.
Thank you.
Did you turn it on the end? It's a light on? Okay.
You will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast, because they trust in you. Isaiah 26:3.
Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us. Ephesians 3:20.
Nehemiah 8:10. Do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength.
Philippians 4:19. But my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight. Proverbs 3:5 and 6.
Philippians 3:14. Press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling us.
I thought of this verse. It's in Hebrews chapter 11, and talking about Abel. And I thought of my mom. And I paraphrased it, changed it into like for my mother, because I think it speaks for her. Through faith, though she is dead, she still speaks. It's talking about the blood of Abel there. We don't need to get into that. But the idea that my mom would want her death to speak as loud as her life. So I come up with four things that my mom would want you to go away with and want you to be thinking about in her death. Hopefully I get through it. Because it's the most important part to her. I was doing okay till this moment. People keep asking me how I'm doing before the service. I said, okay, up to this point. Okay for now. All right, so the first thing. See, that song really displayed her life, didn't it? And for those of you who know her, she suffered greatly. Sorry. It's too early to lose it. It's okay at the end, not yet. What's that? No, I don't. So God better, because I don't. Yeah, but I want him to have my mouth in my emotions. I don't want him to have my back. I want my emotions. Okay, so the first thing, and so when you listen to that song, she really believed that everything was for a purpose. And she was always using whatever trial or pain that she had to tell people about Jesus. What's that? Yeah, we've been doing that. All right. I might need I need that thing, I guess. I don't want the whole box. I have great expectations that I won't need the whole box. Whoops, I better shut that off. I'll blow you guys. So the number one thing that she wanted spoken at, she asked if I would do this service. And of course, I wanted to anyway. But her desire was that every one of you would know Christ as your Savior. So her desire was that every one of you would know Jesus the way she does. That you would be looking forward to heaven. You know, it doesn't help if you guys cry back at me. Gordon, I wouldn't have invited you if I knew you were going to be bawling out there. I just said stay home and watch it online or something. How many here ever heard my mother share the gospel? Would you please put your hand up? I think that sells something, doesn't it? Her main goal in life was to see other people know Jesus the way she did. So, how do you know Jesus the way she did? The Bible talks about that we are all sinners. And our sin separates us from a perfect holy God, the perfect holy God, who's in heaven, who loved us so much that he sent his son, Jesus, to die on the cross for our sins. But because God loves us so much, he does not force us to love him. He does not force us to choose him. He does not. And some people will say, well, if God loved us, he'd let everybody go to heaven. Well, that wouldn't be a God of love, because that would be a God of dictatorship. That would be a God who says, you know, I don't care if you love me on earth, but you're going to come and spend eternity with me. God loved you so much that he gave you the choice to choose him or not, to make a decision, because love is a decision. We know that in marriage, don't we? Sometimes we need to make that decision quite often in order to stay with somebody. Not in my marriage, of course, but in all of yours. But so, even back in the garden, people will say, well, why did God put something in the garden they weren't supposed to do? Because God wanted to give people a choice whether they were going to choose him or not. So he put a tree, and guess what? They disobeyed. And we do the same thing today. We do things we wish we didn't do. We do things that the Bible calls are sin. And it separates us from a perfect holy God, because if heaven is perfect, which it is, and I'm not perfect, and I go there in my imperfection, then what happened to heaven? Am I circular? Am I thinking here? Do you get where I'm going? Are you with me? It means that heaven won't be perfect either. So God had to provide a way for us to become perfect. And he did that by sending his son Jesus. So biblical Christianity is different from all religions in the world in this. All religions of the world say you've got to do something and hopefully it'll be good enough for you to go to heaven. Hopefully. Biblical Christianity, you can choose whether you believe the Bible or not. I do. My mother did. Her faith, no doubt, had an impact on my life. She believed the Bible and everything it said. And that's why she lived her life the way she did. Was she perfect? No. Some of you know her best, really close. You know that somebody mentioned she was soft, and Amber and I laughed because she wasn't always that soft. Dad screwed up. Okay, I'm going to tell you that. The first time he married her, she was soft. Then she got independent for 6 years, and he didn't know what he was getting into that second time. But she loved the Lord, and she wanted to please him with her life. Why? Well, this is what she'd want you to know. That yes, your sin separates you from a perfect holy God, but God loved you so much that he sent his son to pay that payment, that penalty of your sin. He took your debt of sin on himself to provide you the opportunity to go to heaven, to give you his righteousness, which could not come from your own. How many here have ever tried to do right, and the more you try to do right, the more you do wrong? And the rest of you are liars. We can't be good on our own. That's why Christ came. When Jesus died on the cross, he said, it is finished. The work, the payment for sin was final, was accomplished. So Jesus died on the cross for our sins. He paid the payment. In fact, Colossians talks about he took our sin and he nailed it to the cross. But you and I have a dilemma. Because of his love for us, he doesn't force us to accept it. He says, here, I died for you. Choose me or not. Choose that I died for you. See, like I said, all other religions say we have to do something, but biblical Christianity is believing that Jesus did it all already, and all we need to do to be saved is to say, yes, he did it for me. He's not just a distant God, a dead God, somebody out there somewhere who doesn't care. He wants a personal relationship with each one of us. Many of you here have a relationship with Christ. But I know in a group this size, there's many of you who do not. Who you're still, the Bible calls, dead in your sin. And Christ wants to make you alive. You want to know, everybody would always say, oh, Janet, so such a good person. And, you know, and what would she say? It's only because of Christ that I am who I am. It's only because of what he's done in me, done through me. She never took it on herself. And I had an old teacher tell me, who's in this room, well, you can't say it's all Jesus, it's you too. Remember that? He fell asleep. And I pointed him out, so now he'll be awake for a little while. Okay. Louis Prue knows all about that, don't you? When you fall asleep in church, yep. So, God provided a way. Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Too many people say, well, I think I believe. I believe. Yes, I believe, but I'm not sure. The Bible says you can know for sure that you're saved. If you're here this morning, this afternoon, morning, I always mess up on that one. I do it a different time of day. If you're here this afternoon, God wants you to be saved. You didn't come here. God didn't put this together just so that you could come here and think of my mother. God put this together so that you'd come here and think about Jesus and where you stand in relationship to him. Not because he wants to make you miserable, even though he hopes you are a little bit if you're not saved. Only so that you realize that you need him. My mother would hope right now that there's many uncomfortable people in this room. If you don't know Christ as your Savior, because she would want you, she would be begging you to say yes to Jesus. To make a choice to put your faith and trust in Christ. To say, yes, I believe that I'm a sinner. Yes, I believe Jesus died for my sin. And yes, God, by faith, I accept you did it for me. Please save me. Forgive me of my sin. If you've never had a time where you've done that, why not? What's holding you back from putting your faith and trust in Christ as your Savior? You're not sure? You don't see him? He's not right here? Well, I can tell you right now, if you know my mother at all, you could see the evidence of God in her life and even by the way that he saved her so many times. My mother used to pray that she would make it until I was 18. Now, the reason for that was my father wasn't saved and she was afraid I'd live with him and didn't know what would happen with that. And that's not a joke. That is the total truth. He wasn't saved yet. And she was afraid of her little Georgie living with dad. But I want to say this on the other side. She always made sure I was with him when I was supposed to be with my father. Because she knew he was still my dad. Where are you at today? Does this just sound like a good idea? You say, you know what, I don't believe it. Just shut up and let's leave. I'm sure there's some here like that. But I hope, and my mother would hope, that there's some here today that say, you know what? I've never put my faith and trust in Christ as my Savior. I've never made that decision. And I want to make it now. The verse we read earlier, it said something about the example. Mom, live the example of what a Christ follower looks like. Not because she was good, but because Jesus had done a work in her life and changed her. And because of that change, she wanted others to know. And she wants you to know. It wasn't because Mom was so great. It was because she served a great God. Where are you at this afternoon? Have you put your faith and trust in Christ for your salvation? Are you 100% sure, if you were the one in that casket right now, that you'd be in heaven? If it was your body. Do you know why my mother wanted an open casket. You know why? She wanted all of you to know that she is not here. And she's in heaven. That's why we have it open. We're going to have it open after. If you want to view it, that's up to you, whatever. I can tell you right now, it doesn't really matter. She's not there. That's just an empty shell. Thankfully for her, and we're glad for her, but we miss her. But I'm going to give you an opportunity to put your faith and trust in Christ today. This ain't a church service, but the gospel is needed all the time. And my mother showed that. If you're questioning, if you're the Holy Spirit right now is drawing you, and you say, I want that. Not because of Janet, but I want what she had. I want that relationship with God. I realize I'm a sinner. I realize I need a Savior, and I want that today. We're going to pray right now. I'm going to share a prayer that you can say. It's not a prayer that saves you. It's a decision to not put the faith in yourself that you're going to be able to do it, but to put your faith in Jesus that he already did. I kind of look at it this. I like it, illustrations a little bit. And it's like, anybody here have a Christmas present under the tree this winter? You have a Christmas present under there? And your name is on it, right? So Jesus, it says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And I'm coming down to the home stretch, just so you know. And it's like this. So Jesus died, and he has a Christmas gift with your name on under the tree. So everybody has a gift under the tree. Does that gift do you any good while it sits under the tree? When does it do you any good? When you say, yes, that's my name, and you receive it. John 1:12 says, but as many as received him, to them gave you the right to become the children of God. Are you ready to receive Christ? God has a gift for you. I don't care who you are. I don't care what your past is. God doesn't care what you've been through. Like, if you think I've sinned too much or I've done, no. God says, you just come. God's grace is sufficient. So if you're feeling drawn by the Lord right now to accept him, to make a decision for Christ, then let's bow our heads. We're going to pray. And I'm going to pray for you first, and then I'm going to give you a prayer that you can say. And it's not the prayer that saves you. It's the choice. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this group. I thank you for all these who are affected in one way or another, directly or indirectly, by my mother. I thank you for the life that she lived that showed and resembled you, and she just wanted everybody to know who you were. That she just wanted everybody to have that relationship with you that she had. I pray, Lord, for right now, for anybody who your spirit is drawing them, tugging at their heart, and they say, you know what? I've never made that decision, but I want to right now. Give them the courage to do that right now. Help them, Lord, to make that choice. If you're here this afternoon and right now you want to make a decision, just between you and God, it's not about public thing. God knows your heart. Say something like this to him. Say, dear God, I know I'm a sinner. I realize my sin separates me from you. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sin. Forgive me, Lord. Save me now. If you said a prayer like that and you meant it, then you are saved. Your sins are forgiven. And you're on your way to heaven. Lord, I thank you for anybody who's made that decision. And I just pray, Lord, that if there's anyone who still is drawn but still is holding back, Lord, I pray that you will tug on their heart even as they leave this place and go on. That you will hound them until they come to know you as Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. If you made that decision this afternoon, I just say share it. Share it with one of the family. They would love to know because that is what Mom wanted said. So the first thing, and I got four of them, but I won't take that long on all four. So the first thing Mom would want you to know is the gospel. And if you made a decision for Christ today, you are saved, period. You say, well, that sounds simple. It is, but it's not easy because pride keeps me from wanting to say there's a creator God that I'm accountable to and that I need his help to be forgiven. So it's not easy, but it is simple. All right, the second thing she would want is for those of you who know Christ as your Savior to draw closer to God and to start really serving him with your life. My mother was a true servant of the Lord. She hated it when she couldn't do things because she continually wanted to serve him with her life. She wanted to make a difference in people's lives for Christ. And even in the midst of her pain, she'd serve him. Even when it would make her sick the next day, she would serve him. Christian, where are you at today? Are you floating through life? You've got your ticket to heaven, but you're not accomplishing anything for him while you're here? My mother was a great example of being somebody who took it serious that she had a mission while she was still here. She was created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared ahead of time. Her greatest joy was being like a snack shack lady. And many other things, whatever she could do. She hated it when she, of course, she had a little control problem too, but she hated it when she had to let go of some of that, like for the night corn maze and stuff. And I know some of the other snuck in there too. She loved singing and playing her guitar for people. And I remember when she had after she had her first transplant, she would go around and give her testimonies to wherever she could, whoever would let her come and share what God had done in her life. She served him in little ways, in big ways, and in between. She would want you, Christian, to be challenged, to not make excuses for why you're not serving the Lord, for why you're not talking about Jesus. Which goes into my next one, number three. For all to make sharing the gospel, the good news of Jesus, and showing God's love a lifetime priority. Let me read that again. For all to make sharing the good news of Jesus and showing God's love a lifetime priority. She would want that to happen in your life. You know, we're not here just for those of you who don't know Christ as Savior. We're here today for those of you who are saved and just aren't getting going. You're wasting the life. My mom did not waste her life. And then fourthly, that you would finish well. One of my mom's greatest struggles, concerns, I remember 3 years ago stopping in and seeing her, and she was bawling. She was bawling because she was in a lot of pain. But she wasn't crying because of the pain. She was crying because she was afraid that she wouldn't finish well. She was afraid that the pain would keep her from being useful for the Lord. She was afraid of not finishing well. She wanted to finish well for Jesus. So that means, well, in that time, she had that pain actually went away, prayed, and that pain, I mean, she's had pain on and off all her life, but that pain kind of went away. But I want to share one thing about, like, whether she finished well or not. So I'll share a little funny thing, too, maybe. For some of you think it funny, some of you, if you know her well enough, you'll be okay with this. Some of you might not be okay with it. So Friday morning, we're in the hospital, and she was in a severe amount of pain, and her blood pressure was low. And so they wouldn't give her any drugs for the pain because what might it do? Kill her, right? So she goes, I will sign anything. You have no responsibility. I'm not afraid to die. I'm ready. Just take away the pain. If you know her well enough, you can be okay with that. Why could she say that? Because she knew where she was going, for one thing, and she was not afraid of death. So that was Friday morning. Friday afternoon, they kind of got the pain under control, and she was still alive. And we were able to talk and pray with her. But Friday afternoon, which was like the last time she was really alert, you know what she was doing? She shared the gospel and her testimony with the nurse. She finished well. She finished well. You guys, stop crying. Bawling like a baby, and you ain't even up here. Would that be on your mind? If you knew you might be dying in the next few days, would it be a concern about that person right there that you want to go to heaven to? Or would you be so self-focused on the pain that you're doing that you wouldn't be able to talk about Jesus? My mother would want us to say, would want four things for you to get a confidence, for you to hear today. One is that if you're not saved, you come to know him as your Savior. And if you are saved, number two, that you would draw closer to God and start really serving him with your life. Number three, that you would be, well, let's send you one more. I think that'll be my last one. I think I didn't need the whole thing. Well, good. Okay, so for all to share the good news of Jesus and to show God's love, a lifetime priority. And if you are saved, that you would finish well. Finish well. So, the next song that's going to be sang by, are you going to be able to do it? By some granddaughters. This is totally what Mom wanted. And then after the song is sung, the song is I Can Only Imagine. It's talking about heaven. She wanted that played, and then Micah is going to come up, and he's going to read a poem that my mom wrote, kind of based on the song. So, you ready?
Good job.
I made it almost. Whoops.
By your glory, what will
imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Good afternoon. I have the privilege of reading a poem my grandmother wrote called I Can Only Imagine, Now I Know. I once imagined a day when an angel would come to me and say, Janet, it's time to come home. Now I know. I once imagined what it would be like to wake up on the shores of heaven. Now I know. I once imagined gazing into the loving eyes of Jesus. Now I know. I once imagined having a scar-free body. Now I know. I once imagined how it would be like to run without pain or shortness of breath. Now I know. I once imagined the joyful reunion with Christian friends and family that had gone to heaven before me. Now I know. I once tried to imagine the awesome beauty of heaven, but now I know. Do not weep for me, my precious family and friends. I'm in heaven. I'd stake my life on it. And here there is no pain, no suffering, total peace, and best of all, there is the one, Jesus Christ, who gave his life that I and anyone else who accepts his gift of salvation could come, live, not just for 80 to 100 years like on earth, but forever and ever. This is my last chance to share with you about this great gift that I accepted when I was 20. Jesus has never let me down all these years since. If you never accept this gift too, then this is goodbye. But if you do accept it, it can be just see you later. Today is the day of salvation. None of us know when our time on earth is up, and then it will be too late. Please accept him today. Looking forward to see you. Love and God bless. Janet.
So we're going to finish today by singing a song. One thing, as Christians, we don't grieve without hope. We grieve with it. So would you stand with us and sing?
In the
of life repaid when we all get to Him. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory.
So you can be seated just for one more thing. We're going to play one song. One thing that we believe happened when Mom got to heaven's gates is we believe Jesus said, well done, thou good and faithful servant. So we have a song here with just a slideshow of some pictures showing her being a servant.
What will it be like when my pain is gone and all the worries of this world just fade away? What will it be like when you call my name in that moment when I see you face to face? I'm waiting
day. Until then, I'll live to hear you say, well done.
Thank you for coming today to celebrate the life of my mother. She, you know that she was a very detailed person. And she wants on her tombstone, it's right there. It's right there. No, that's not all of it. Only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. For me to live is Christ and to die is gain. I hope today is not just another funeral for you. I hope it's an opportunity to be touched, not by my mother, but by Jesus. Because that's what my mother would want. We'll close in prayer. We're going to have a meal. It's a meal that my mother likes. It's chicken and biscuits. So if a bunch of you would just help, I appreciate it, to kind of move the red chairs forward. We got tables in the side room here. We'll get them all set up and quickly. And my mother would want more. We didn't do a burial right after this because Mom would want people hanging out and just chatting. She was always into big groups just hanging out and loving on each other. And so that's why we kind of set this up in the evening. Also, is so that for those of you who want to, we're more than happy to have you hang around and just talk about her, talk about Jesus, talk about whatever. But she loved that. So that's what we're doing. So let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for loving us, for loving my mother, for saving her, even when she was young and she thought she was a Christian, but then she realized she had never put her faith and trust in you. And when she did, whoa, my word, what a change that came over. Thank you for her life, Lord, the example. She's one that could say, imitate me as I imitate Christ. And so, Lord, thank you for her life. Thank you for her death, that you've taken her and she's home with you in glory without pain, without suffering, and having an eternal joy. I pray for each one here, Lord. I pray that those who don't know you as Savior would not leave here without being triggered, being touched by what you did for my mom and what you can do for them, what you want to do. Help them to understand just how much you love them, Lord. I pray for those who are saved here that you would help them to not live a ho-hum Christian life, but to truly maybe even rededicate their life today to you, to be sold out to you in what they do, what they say, to have a renewed vigor, maybe similar to what they had when they first got saved, to tell others about Jesus. Lord, being challenged by the example that Mom was, even up until the very last at least alert hour anyway. Thank you for my mom's example that has helped me in life and grown me. And I thank you for each one, how she's affected each one here. Guide us, Lord, as we go from here. May we go forward being more godly because we are here today. In Jesus' name, amen.